All right, let's take a look at our seventh example from chapter 6. Water is pumped at a flow rate of 2.25 kilograms per minute from 1 bar 20 degrees C to 15 bar. Determine the amount of work and the temperature of water at the exit if the efficiency of the pump is 78%. All right, so we have a pump. So pumps are used to move liquids. Okay, so going into my pump, I'm going to have a liquid at a temperature of 20 degrees C and a pressure of 1 bar. Okay, and I know at 1 bar the saturation temperature is 100 degrees C, so I have a compressed liquid here. All right, and, you know, I emphasize that liquids are used to move liquids. Pumps are used to move liquids. So it's imperative that my stream going in and my exiting stream both correspond to a liquid. If my exiting stream is two-phase or vapor, that's a problem, right? That means I have something called cavitation going on in my pump, which is problematic. Okay, so pumps are used to move liquids. We're going to perform work, right, on my system to increase the pressure of my stream. And so here we're told that the exiting pressure, P2, is equal to 15 bar. Okay, we're not told T2, but we're told P2. So in a pump, I'm performing work on my system to increase the pressure of my liquid to move it downstream. Okay, so we have T1 and P1, we have P2, we're performing work. I'm going to assume that we're operating at steady state. So M.1 would be equal to M.2 would be equal to M., and that would be equal to this 2.25 kilograms per minute that we're given. All right, now the last piece of information we're given is we're given the efficiency of the pump. We're told the efficiency is equal to 0.78. Okay, so for a pump, when I think about efficiency, the efficiency is going to correspond to the work actually required, okay, divided by the work required in the reversible case. Okay. So we're going to look at the work relative to the work for the reversible process. Okay, and the reversible process, so W reversible, okay, so a reversible process is going to correspond to the case when Sgen is equal to zero. All right, so I need to calculate the work required work for the reversible process. Once I have the required work for the reversible process, which corresponds to Sgen is equal to zero, I'll be able to calculate the actual work required for this pump. And then I'm, hopefully with that, okay, I don't know T2, but then between my first law balance and entropy balance, that I can use that W to solve for T2. Okay, so hopefully that makes sense. So again, the procedure is going to be, is for this pump, we'll first consider the reversible case, which corresponds to Sgen equals zero. So I'm thinking entropy balance. And so we ultimately want to solve for the required reversible work. And then once we have the required reversible work, we can use the efficiency to get to W. Okay. Then once we have W, all right, we'll take a pause and we'll come back, think through this, and then work backwards to try and solve for T2. All right. So first, let me just make a couple of blanket assumptions. So in the past, we would make assumptions when we wrote down our general first law balance. But since I'm going to start out with an entropy balance, since I'm looking for that reversible case, I just want to write down some assumptions in general just to make clear. Okay. Okay. So my first assumption, and so they're going to be, well, my first two assumptions are going to be pretty standard, okay, and so I'm sure you could anticipate them, right? The first is going to be steady state, okay, so that's going to mean that my accumulation term is zero, and so my inlet and outlet mass flow rate are going to be the same as well. Two, I'm going to assume that the change in kinetic energy and potential energy are negligible. And then the last one I'm going to assume, okay, so for my pump, is that we're asked to solve for T2, right? So I'm taking this to imply that T1 is not equal to T2. If T1 and T2 were equal, I would interpret this as being operated isothermally, right? So that any heat generated by the pump, right, would be absorbed by that cooling fluid. Okay, but this is suggesting T1 and T2 are not the same. So I'm going to assume that my pump is being operated adiabatically, so that there's no heat exchange between my pump and the surroundings. It's an assumption I'm going to make based on what we're given in the problem. Okay, so the third assumption I'm going to make is that Q dot is equal to zero, that there's no exchange of heat between my pump and my surroundings. Okay, all right, so the first thing I want to do is we want to solve for the reversible case. Okay, and the reversible case is going to correspond to S gen is equal to zero. All right, so if I write down my entropy balance, thinking back to chapter 4, okay, S gen is equal to delta S of my system plus delta S of my surroundings. Okay, and delta S of my system, right, in theory, right, in general, in this chapter, we're thinking this as, S dot gen, the rate of entropy generation. Delta S of system would be m dot 2 times S2 minus m dot 1 times S1. And then the surrounding terms we'll tackle in a second, but you'd multiply that by mass flow rate as well to make it a rate. Okay, but since we're operating at steady state, the mass flow rate's constant, we can write this in the same form as we've had back in chapter 4. So anyways, I'm going to tackle delta S of surroundings. So delta S of my surroundings. Okay, I'm going to assume that my surroundings can be treated as a bath. So it'll be delta S of bath. And so that'll be equal to Q bath over T bath, where Q bath is going to be the opposite, right, of the heat of my system. So it'd be negative Q over T bath. Okay. But I just said I'm going to assume that this is operating adiabatically, so the Q is zero. So I get that delta S of my surroundings is equal to zero. Therefore, okay, since I'm looking at the reversible case of S gen is equal to zero, means that delta S of my system is equal to zero, which is equal to S2 minus S1, right, is equal to zero. All right, so I get that S2 is equal to S1, or the change in entropy from my inlet and outlet is zero. All right, cool. So now in theory, okay, I said I know this is a compressed liquid. So like the last problem, I could go to the saturate or the steam tables. I know I have a compressed liquid. I could assume that the entropy at 20 degrees C in 1 bar is approximately equal to that at of the saturated liquid at 20 degrees C. The corresponding saturation pressure, find S1, then I know S2, and then use that combination of P2 and S2 to pin down the state of my system. Okay, but we saw in the last problem that it's kind of hard reading from the steam tables. We ended up not even finding a temperature change. And so we could go that same route, right, of pinning down S2 and using that to categorize our system. But I'm going to try something slightly different. So I'm going to stop with my entropy balance, right? So I know the change in entropy is zero. I'm just going to make a note that since delta S is equal to zero, all right, I would take that to ds, that ds is equal to zero. All right. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to jump to my first law of balance. Okay, for this reversible case, and then see how we can use this finding that ds is equal to zero to further simplify our first law balance. So we're going to try something new. Okay, all right, so if I write down my first law balance for my open system, So I'll write it down in general. Then we'll simplify based on the assumptions that we've already said. So we have change in kinetic plus potential plus enthalpy is equal to Q dot plus W dot. Okay, but we assumed adiabatic. Kinetic energy and potential energy, change in kinetic and potential is negligible. And our accumulation term is zero since we're at steady state. And also our mass flow rate then is constant. Okay, so that would get us to H2 minus H1, okay, which is equal to delta H is just equal to, and actually let me multiply by M so we can kill it. So H2 minus H1 times M dot is equal to W dot. But, you know, W dot over M dot is just W. Okay. So we end up with H2 minus H1 is equal to W. Okay, so now where I'm going to try something a little different is we could solve this just like the last problem, where again, I know T1 and P1, I could use that, I could go to my steam tables, assume that my properties at 20 degrees C and 1 bar are approximately equal to that of the saturated liquid at 20 degrees C and the corresponding saturation pressure, and I could read off H1 and S1. Then S2 is going to be equal to S1, and then with that, I could, you know, with that S2 and pressure of 15 bars, I could, I could go and I could find H and T2 and then use that to calculate the work. So let's try that, and then let's try a different approach where we try and mess with our differential and this requirement that DS is zero. Okay. All right, so my inlet stream, right, was that T1 is 25 degrees C and P1 is equal to 1 bar. Okay, let's see, was it 25 degrees C or 20 degrees C? 20 degrees C. Okay, so we're gonna try and tackle this reversible case in two ways, and we're going to see if it makes a difference. All right, so that's 20 degrees C. So we have a compressed liquid. So again, taking enthalpy as an example, we're going to assume that my enthalpy at T1 and P1 is approximately equal to, so this is going to be a liquid, the enthalpy of my saturated liquid at T1 and, you know, the corresponding saturation pressure, okay, where P1 is going to be greater than Psat. So if I do that, okay, and we're going to see if we can actually get anything out of this. So 20 degrees C, so saturation pressure is 0.02 bar, so I guess not too far away this time. I'm going to record the liquid volume just because, well, just for speculation. All right, for plan B if we attempt it. Okay, so I'm going to take V1, okay, to be equal to molar volume of the specific volume of the saturated liquid, 0.001002. So 0.001002, and that's meters cubed per kilogram. Okay, then let's get H1 and let's get S1. So H1 is enthalpy of my liquid 83.92. That's kilojoules per kilogram. And S1 is 0.2965. Okay, so where, you know, I'm thinking working with the steam tables are going to be problematic is, so P2 is at 15 bar. All right, P2 is at 15 bar. And now we know that S2, I'll write it down here, S2 is equal to S1 is equal to 0.2965, and this is kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin. Okay, and this number we found by assuming that our liquid was incompressible. Okay, so if I go to my steam tables, so if I go to my superheated steam tables and I find a pressure of 15 bar, okay, which good, it's on here. Okay, so we're looking for an entropy of 0.2965. So the saturated liquid, so I have a saturation temperature of 198.30, right, has an entropy of 2.3147, and then it increases from there as temperature increases. All right, so I'd be further to the left. All right, so we end up, if I was working with the steam tables, I'd end up having to make the same assumption as before, okay, that we assume that, you know, the properties at my temperature and pressure of interest are equal to the corresponding saturated liquid at the same temperature and some unknown pressure Psat. But then we would end up with the, you know, non-unique solution that if I'm looking for, you know, entropy of a liquid of 0.2965, right, the only case I'm going to find that is where I'm at 20 degrees C again. Okay, so we would end up finding, all right, that we're at the same state. Okay, so we'd end up getting, you know, T2 is equal to T1. So using steam tables, let me just say. So I'd get the non, you know, cool solution that T2 is equal to T1. So then, you know, V2 would be equal to V1. H2 would be equal to H1. All right, and since H2 is equal to H1, I'd get W is equal to 0. Okay, so this problem, you know, so using the steam tables, assuming that I'm incompressible, doesn't make sense in this case. And, you know, we kind of saw that in the last example, but we just went with it in that, you know, yeah, it's an approximation to assume that it's incompressible, but, you know, the results, you know, don't make sense when we do that for particular cases. Okay, so this would get that the change in temperature is essentially 0, which, you know, might be okay. All right, might, you know, turn out to be the case. I think we'll find a delta T pretty close to 0, but assuming that the work required then is 0, you know, isn't so much. So let's try a different route. Okay, let's try a different route. Okay, and so the route I'm going to try is I'm going to go back to my definition of entropy, right? Because I know that dS is equal to 0. So I'm going to go back to my definition of entropy and see if I can use this fact that dS is equal to 0 to get some sort of alternative expression for H2 minus H1 is equal to W. Now, if we had, you know, vigorously worked through Chapter 5, we'd be able to cook up said property relationships, but we didn't. So I'm solely going to think of this in terms of the first and second law. All right, so going back to the second law and my definition of entropy, we have that TdS is equal to dQ reversible. All right, well, dQ reversible, okay, I could think of my first law, and I have dU is equal to dQ reversible plus dW, where, if I assume that my only work is via a boundary, then we had the dW was equal to negative P dV. All right, remember, I'm thinking about my definition of entropy, right, which was introduced in Chapter 4. Okay, so dU is dQ reversible minus P dV. So dQ reversible is equal to dU plus P dV. All right, so the next thing I'm going to do might not seem obvious at first, okay? But, you know, if I wanted to, say, integrate this to get, you know, Q reversible, difference in U, and, you know, my work term, okay, this is suggesting that we have an independent variable of V. Okay. When I look at my problem, we're characterizing my inlet and outlet using temperature and pressure, and so it'd be desirable if I could get an independent variable of p instead of v. And so how we're going to do that is by recalling our definition of enthalpy. Okay, so enthalpy was defined as being equal to u plus pv. So the differential of enthalpy then is equal to the differential of u plus pv, which is equal to the differential of u plus the differential of pv, where that's going to be equal to du plus product rule, pdv plus vdp. Okay, cool. So if I look at how does that help me out at all? Well, that's a good question. If I look up here, I have dq reversible is du plus pdv. Okay, well, here I have, so I have dh. How do I want to get this? I'm going to do dh. I want to keep du plus pdv. So dh minus vdp is equal to du plus pdv. Okay. So what this tells me then, okay, is I can rewrite this as dq reversible is equal to dh minus vdp. Okay, since du plus pdv is equal to dh minus vdp. And for my definition of entropy, that's equal to TdS. All right, how does that help me? Well, let me get a new page. Okay, so I have the TdS is equal to dh minus vdp. Well, we just showed that for our reversible process, okay, the ds was equal to 0. Okay, so for our reversible process, we end up with dh is equal to vdp. Okay, so again, this is for our reversible process. Okay, so dH is equal to vdP, and you know our first law of balance is that delta H is equal to W. Okay, so we get, all right, so W is equal to delta H. So W is equal to delta H. So that's going to be the integral from 1 to 2 dH, which now is going to be equal to my integral from 1 to 2 of v dp. All right, so w I could take as being the integral from 1 to 2 of v dp. All right, how does that help me out? Okay, well, you know, before when we were talking about, you know, we're assuming our fluid's incompressible, we're assuming that all of our properties at of our compressed liquid were equivalent to the corresponding saturated liquid at the same temperature. So here what I'm going to do is, you know, I know that my pressure is different, okay? Now I know that my volume, right, is going to be a function of temperature and pressure, okay? So what I'm assuming, though, for a pump, right, is if we use the steam tables, we estimated a delta T of zero, that the temperature was unchanged, okay? So, you know, I'm assuming it's not exactly zero, right? It's not going to be exactly zero because otherwise we'd have a work of zero, okay? But I'm going to assume that the change in temperature is pretty small, okay? So I'm going to assume that the change in temperature is pretty small. And then further, all right, I'm going to assume that the molar volume or specific volume in this case, we'll assume that the specific volume is independent of pressure so that this volume, the specific volume, doesn't change much with respect to pressure. Okay, because if I go that route so that I can assume V is constant, I end up with W is equal to V times the integral from 1 to 2 of dP, And so that's going to be V times P2 minus P1. Okay. So for my pump, I'm going to approximate the work, or estimate the work for my reversible operation as being equal to V times P2 minus P1, where since I know that my inlet's at 25 degrees C in one bar, I'll use that to estimate my specific volume, and then I'll take my difference in P. Cool. All right. So, again, I said I was going a different route, and at least in this process, or, you know, in this way, W will not be equal to 0 since P2 is not equal to P1. All right, so what am I going to use as V? Well, from the steam tables, you know, if we wanted to at 20 degrees C in one bar, the molar volume or specific volume of the corresponding saturated liquid is 0.001 meter cubed per kilogram. Okay, so, you know, remember, you know, in general, the density of water is what, 1 gram or 1 gram per cubic centimeter, right? 1 gram per milliliter. And so this is essentially that. Okay. So I'm going to take, I'm assuming that V is equal to V1, or approximately equal to V1. And we looked that up, 0.001002 meters cubed per kilogram. Okay. So that's in SI units. That is wonderful. Okay. So you already see the volume's pretty small. If we had a, you know, vapor phase, the volume would be larger. So the corresponding work to pressurize that would be larger, right? Cool. All right, so that's V1. Now I have P2 and P1. But when I compute this, I'll want to convert from bars to pascals. I'll just keep everything in SI units so that work will have units of, so it's on a molar basis, joules per kilogram. All right, let's see what happens when we do this. So if I pull MATLAB up then. Okay, so... I'm going to assume V is 0.001002. Did I get that right? Then 1 in 15. Okay, P1 is going to be equal to, so my inlet pressure is 1 bar. Okay. So 1 bar is 1 times 10 to the 5 pascals, so I'm going to write that as 1e to the 5. P2 was 15, so I'm going to write that as 15e to the 5. Okay, and so again, I'm just keeping everything in SI units so that my units work out. I know in other courses you spend a lot of time with unit conversions. Here, it's a matter of, I don't want unit conversions to, you know, distract from, you know, application of thermo. All right, so W was V times P2 minus P1, okay? And this should give us a positive work, which is what we want. Okay, so let me save this as... So I get a work of 1,402.8. And so I'm going to label this reversible. So my reversible work is equal to 1,402.8. And that is going to be in joules per kilogram. Yeah. Cool. So my reversible work is 1,402.8 joules per kilogram. All right. So now, all right, we're told that the pump operates with an efficiency of 78%. So, okay, I'm going to define my efficiency as, let's see, so I have it written here as the actual work divided by the reversible work, okay? But now that I think about it, the reversible work, right, should be smaller than the actual work, right? The reversible case should correspond to the minimum amount of work that needs to be done on my system. So as I think through this, just to make sure I get things right, okay, it should be, what I'm thinking in my head is it should be W reversible over W. Ooh, now, so I've calculated W reversible. Now, we're told that the pump operates at an efficiency of 78%. So, the reversible case, when I'm operating reversibly and there's no losses, so again, Q is equal to zero, that should correspond to the minimum amount of work that would be required to pressurize our liquid. Okay, we're talking about work done on our system. But no, I still think it's W divided by W reverse. Let me run with that, and then we will. No, it's got to be the opposite, because the work required has to be greater. Sorry, I had a moment there. So, compared to what I had originally, I was thinking in terms of, you know, our turbine where our system was doing work, right? So, when we had a turbine, the purpose is to, say, expand our fluid, and our fluid's going to produce work. Right, so our efficiency would be the actual work divided by the work that would be generated in the reversible case. Why? Because in the reversible case, that's going to correspond to the case where we get the maximum amount of work possible out of that system. In our pump and compressor, right, it's the opposite. Right, now we're going to do work on our system. So the reversible case is going to correspond to the case where we do the minimum amount of work or required to the case where we have the minimal amount of work necessary to pressurize our fluid, okay, pump, liquid, compressor, or gas. Okay, in an actual process, the required work is going to be larger. Okay, so our efficiency, right, so since we're going to keep this, you know, between 0 and 1 or, you know, 0 and 100%, it's going to be the reversible work divided by the actual work. Okay, so therefore, once we have the reversible work, which we've estimated here, okay, again, it's eta is going to be equal to the reversible work, which is the minimum case, divided by W. Okay, so therefore, W is going to be equal to W reversible over eta. Okay, so we're given an efficiency. So let me call this W reverse. So we're given an efficiency of 0.78, right? I believe, right? So we're given an efficiency of 0.78. So work is going to be the reversible work divided by the efficiency. Okay, and it should be larger, right? So the actual required work is going to be 1,798.5. Okay, so let me label this the reversible work. Okay, that is, I did label it reversible work. So my actual work is going to be 1,798.5, and that's going to be joules per mole. All right, then the question asks, all right, so given the given the amount of work, we want to know what's the temperature at the exit. Okay, so first thing is this work, okay, is in terms of joules per mole. If we wanted a rate, so if we want W dot, okay, remember W is equal to W dot divided by M dot. So if I want W dot, that's going to be equal to M dot times W, okay, where M dot is the mass flow rate that we're given. Okay, so just for completeness, W dot is going to be equal to, okay, we have a mass flow rate of, so this is in kilograms per minute. So let me do some conversions here. So M in kilogram minute is equal to 2.25. So if I'm keeping things in SI units, so if I want to convert, so let me get kilogram per minute. If I want to get to kilogram per second, second being SI, that'd be equal to the mass flow rate in kilograms per minute. And then I have 1 minute is 60 seconds. Right. So kilogram per minute multiplied by 1 minute is equivalent to 60 seconds. So it would be divided by 60. Okay. So then if I want my work rate, okay, so that's going to be equal to, and I'm going to keep this in SI units. So if I have kilograms per second, and before we had joules per kilogram. I don't know why I wrote, said joules per mole, joules per kilogram. So if I have joules per kilogram, and I'm multiplying by kilograms per second, that gives me joules per second. And a joule per second is equal to a watt. So W rate is going to be equal to M in kgs times W. Okay, so my work is going to be 67.4423 watts. Okay, so this would be 67.4423 watts. Okay, and a watt's equivalent to a joule per second. All right, now I need to calculate T. So I'm going to go back to my first law of balance. So we had simplified it up here. All right, so for this problem we had that H2 minus H1 is equal to W. Okay, so we have W is equal to H2 minus H1, okay? All right, now again, right, we could, you know, attempt to, we could look up H1, right, by assuming that the properties of my compressed liquid are equivalent to the saturated liquid at the same temperature, okay? And then, so we can get H1. To get H2, well, now we're not going to be able to use Sgen is equal to 0, so we won't get the S2 is equal to S1. So S2 will be greater than S1. So it would be kind of, so we'd be stuck there. And we don't have an ideal gas, so we're kind of, you know, we're kind of held up there in our adiabatic process. So, what I'll do, right, is I'll, you know, take W to be equal to H2 minus x1, and that'll be the integral from 1 to 2 of cp dt. So if I'm working again with my compressed liquid, okay, it should be that the heat capacity of water, so the definition of a calorie is what the heat required to raise 1 cubic centimeter of water by 1 degree C. And so let's see, can I get, let's just do a Google search, because I want a constant value. Yeah, so it's 4,184 joules per kilogram, right? And calorie is 4.184. So one calorie is 4.184 joules, right? So calories based on the definition of the heat required to raise 1 cubic centimeter of water, which is equal to 1 gram of water, 1 degree C. Okay? So I'll write that as 4,184 joules per kilogram Kelvin. So I'm going to take Cp to be constant over this small temperature range. We're dealing with water at room temperature, 4,184, and that's joules per kilogram Kelvin. Right, 4,184 joules per kilogram Kelvin. All right, so then if we do that, and so assume Cp is constant for our incompressible liquid. Okay. Now, I should note, you can't just go to the steam tables. In the steam tables, what we're given are heat capacities of an ideal gas. Okay, and so you can't use your ideal gas heat capacity where here we have compressed liquid water. So that'd be problematic. If I think about trying to use my cubic equation of state, the issue is I don't know my outlet temperature. Okay, and so I'm kind of stuck, and I don't have the S2 is equal to S1 because we're going to have a non-reversible case here. So it's going to be that Sgen's not zero and S2 is greater than S1. Okay, so based on what we have, so this is the approach I'm going to take. So assuming Cp is constant, right, this is just Cp T2 minus T1. Okay, so I would get a, oh, and so I have W, okay, and that's going to be equal to Cp T2 minus T1. So let's solve for T2. Okay, so W divided by Cp is equal to T2 minus T1. So T2 is going to be equal to T1 plus W over Cp. All right, W, we had SI units, joules per kilogram. So if Cp is joules per kilogram Kelvin, W over Cp will have units of Kelvin. So let's just make sure T1 is in Kelvin. Okay. So T1, so our initial temperature was 20 degrees C. So I'm going to add to it 273.15 to get it in Kelvin. Okay, so Cp, we had 4,184, and that's joules per kilogram Kelvin. And so then T2 was equal to T1 plus W divided by Cp. Some estimate of T2. Let me convert from, let me convert back to degree C. So in degree C, it's going to be T2 minus 273.15. Okay, and I suppose I could have kept it in Celsius since this is T2 minus T1 a difference, but all is the same. So I'd get 20.4298. So T2 is 20.4298, okay, degrees C. So what we would find is for the second case, so, you know, for a reversible case, we assume that, you know, our specific volume was constant, which seems reasonable. And that based on the efficiency, we get our actual work, and then we assume a constant pressure or constant heat capacity. And so the heat capacity at 25 degrees C or 20 degrees C would be completely reasonable, because with that, we estimate a really small change in temperature, just 0.4 degrees C. So for our pump, all right, we estimate it requires 67.4423 watts to operate, and that the change in temperatures is small. Okay. So, you know, one aside, okay, so the, you know, equation wouldn't necessarily be accurate, but if I think about a compressor, so in a compressor, we're increasing the pressure of gases. And so in general, when I think about, so I'm a chemical engineer, when I think about a chemical plant, right, it's always we're moving liquids around our plant. Why? It's a lot easier to move liquids via pump than it is to move gases via compressor, right? And so, you know, this can give you, you know, kind of an idea into that, where if I'm compressing a gas, the specific volume is not going to be constant, right? It's not going to be independent of temperature and pressure. But nonetheless, even for, you know, this case, we see that the work scales with volume. All right, so if I have a much larger specific volume as I would in a gas, right, I'm going to get a much larger required work for that reversible process. Okay, so as specific volume increases, that work is going to go up. All right, and so compressing gases is a lot more complicated from an energy standpoint in terms of work requirement. And then also, if it's operating adiabatically, dealing with temperature control, and if it's operating isothermally, you know, having to deal with removing the heat from our process. Okay, but that's a whole nother animal. So, you know, sorry, there was a lot of, you know, small little assumptions and changes that had to be done in this one, but hopefully that helps.